Before we get started today, could I just ask, did everyone who intends to hand in assignment one hand it in on Friday? Were there any struggles? Okay, so the some solutions are just up online now. If you want to, I mean, don't go and look at them right now, but when you want to, they're on the model page. I was just looking at them again, and for whichever one it was that was difficult, three part four or something like that, both solutions I was talking about are there. Although when I was looking at it just now, I feel like one of the two solutions I gave should have more carefully checked a few things, like whether you were dividing by zero in a few places, like that, actually solving the eigenvector equations. I'm not sure I would have given 4 points to my own solution in that one. Okay, so where were we? So we defined a Boolean algebra of sets. And in particular, we defined sigma algebras, which were Boolean algebras, which also. I heard the right word between the two of you, the whole sentence is.
Closed
on a kind of Boolean. Yeah, so here we just guaranteed to have the empty set of the whole set, closed on the complements and finite Booleans. Here we've also got arbitrary kind of Booleans. And that also then gives you kind of intersections. Okay, so we did talk a little bit about the Borel sigma algebra. So, just a particular example is V sigma algebra generated by open sets. Last lecture, and what can go wrong is in a, what did we say, a separable metric space? Generated by open walls. And although we got it wrong in lecture on Friday, I think the Waddle discussion forum had a reasonable explanation of how to do that. Although there was something I didn't like about the version that I posted. There was something really terrifyingly non-constructive about the proof that I gave on Waddle. If you like those issues, you might go back and obsess about the proof I gave, see if you comment about it. Okay, so here's another question, which is a general exercise. So what conditions on X? Even, possibly none. So the Borel sigma algebra is generated by compact sets. But I'll leave you guys just to think about that one. But then let's just go back to Rn and say some things that are true in Rn. I guess reproduce notation, I guess. So this notation, not really particularly standard, but I'll try and use this one. It's what Terry Tao uses in his measure theory book. I think a good reason for these square brackets is just that calligraphic B with parentheses, we've already used up in this course the bounded operator on the open space. I think the square brackets are just to make it look a bit different from that. Okay, so this Borel sigma algebra, whoops, we hit the brackets wrong, of Rn is generated by what? Any other suggestions? Things we could alternatively work. ways we could generate realm sets for our symbols. I think that's probably true back here. Does it actually matter? Can you do closed walls as well? I have to think of it. No, it's
Because if you have closed walls, you can actually do the final
walls. Oh, I take it as if, of course, great. The suggestion there was just that you can make a closed ball as a final, as a countable for the second of open balls by taking your radius plus one over eight. And similarly, you can make open balls by closed balls going out the board. Okay, but here, the thing that I wanted to suggest was that you could do this by boxes. Okay, that is products of intervals in Rn, and in fact, that's maybe just squeezing. Down here, you can even do rational coordinate boxes, which maybe is more useful in some ways. Certainly, this is showing that the Borel sets in Rn are generated by some countable collection of things. Those kinds of things. You can even sometimes it's you might even want to go down to much smaller things, like you could have dyadic coordinate boxes. Dyadic means rational numbers in the form k over 2 n for some values of k and n. So the point of these is just to emphasize that there are lots of different versions of how you generate Borel sets, but these are sort of good exercises, proving that you have two different generating sets of the same sigma algebra is always just a matter of saying that, well, given these sorts of gadgets, say, you can build those using the operations from a sigma algebra from the generator, from some other set of generators, and vice versa. Okay. So while we're talking exercises, let me just suggest a few more things that are good to think about to make sure you understand sigma algebras. So if E and F are Borel, maybe this is obvious, but a Borel set is just a set in the Borel sigma algebra. So E and F are Borel in Rn and Rm. You can show the product is Borel in the Rn plus n, but you have to be a bit careful here. Is not true for the main sets. Is that really what I want to say? No, so that's good. That must be so. Okay. I want to say that about the next exercise. Okay. So the next exercise, going back here, this feels like looking at the statement like it must be really, really simple. But it actually does take a little bit of work. The first hint is prove this first. Would you assume that one of these Borel sets is actually just a box? And then there's a second step to it for arbitrary Borel sets in F. And then the sort of second hint is make sure that if you're not using an idea like this to do this exercise, then you're not making a mistake. Because I think it is easy to think that something simpler works. You should be trying something. Here's another one. So if E is Borel, this is sort of intended as a converse. So if you just have some Borel set in Rn plus n, and you define this slice, x to all of those y in Rm, so x, y is in E. Okay, you're just picking some coordinate x in Rn and just taking a cut through. wanted to point out as dangerous, show this doesn't necessarily happen. For the vague sense. That is, you can have a perfectly good vague measurable set in our n plus n, but it might have slices that aren't the vague sets, which is a bit horrible. That's not too hard. Maybe we should talk about this. Does anyone have a sense of why this sort of thing might happen? Let's talk about this now.
I think if I cross a non-measurable set with a set that has measure zero.
Great. Yeah.
And I was going to ask a question. Does it still work if both the pieces in some sense have non-zero measure? Oh, I guess it doesn't make sense to have both the pieces. But what if the big set has non-zero measure?
I see. You want to take E and assume that it's the big measurable with positive measure.
Yeah.
No, it's still easy to break this. I mean, I doubt you can't make every slice non-Lemaitre-measurable, but it's certainly easy to have some slices. Because you can always just take something. I mean,
on a non-measure zero set?
Yeah, probably.
It wasn't a theorem in the last two, but I forgot this example. Are there some conditions you could do that?
Yeah, I think we'll come back to exactly this sort of question when we get back to Fibonacci-Tonelli for general measure spaces. So we'll come back. But so just what's sort of the problem that goes on with Lemaitre? So take C to be something non-measurable, non-Lemaitre measurable. In R, then the point is that C cross zero is Lemaitre measurable. In R2. And why is that? It's actually because we did something really stupid when constructing Lemaitre measure. So the really stupid thing we did. So what does it mean for a single algorithm to be complete? Sorry, maybe I can't say single algorithm. I've got to talk about measures before we can do that. So we're not quite there, but. Let's say in measure space, even though we technically haven't quite defined it yet, is complete if what is complete.
Can you see
no, it's a completely different meaning of complete this time. So you say in measure space is complete if every subset of a null set. Is measurable, and then it has to be measure zero because it's a subset. Okay, so you might want this property that if you ever meet a set that's measurable and has measure zero, you might want to declare that all of its subsets also have measure zero as well.
What's a null set?
A null set, is set with measure zero. So this seems like a pretty reasonable property to want from a measure. Anytime you have some set of measure zero, its subsets should also count as having measure zero. But that doesn't actually follow from the axioms anywhere. And so we say a measure space is complete, if that's true. And so here's the thing. So you can complete a measure. You do that just by throwing in all subsets of null sets. And in fact, the Lebesgue sigma algebra constructed the main measure, we actually made an analysis to hopefully whoever did it said at some point that basically this was a step in just saying what counts as the main measurable sense, that all the null sets, the subsets of null sets, of measure zero sets were in there as well. But it's sort of a stupid thing to do. Even though this feels like it's a sort of temptingly nice property that feels natural, it's actually often not that useful. And it results in stupid things happening. Okay? This guy, the reason why this counts as Lebesgue measurable is because, basically because of this. C cross zero is a subset of R cross zero, which we decided is measure zero, when Lebesgue measure. So we then, because we said we're going to complete it, make Lebesgue measure a complete measure, we had to throw in all of these guys. But that's kind of lame, because it means that this is no longer true. And even though analysis 2 made a big deal of Lebesgue measure, I sort of want to take the approach this time around that actually Borel is maybe better. It was sort of, for most purposes, it's actually not really necessary to complete your measure space and throw in all the subsets and null sets. Okay. Implicitly, of course, there's a theorem hiding there when we say is, which I think I'm not going to attempt to go and prove. But you might think about it. Okay. Enough about sigma algebras for a little bit. I've definitely done things out of order here because I started saying I started defining adjectives on measure spaces, and we haven't officially defined measure space yet. Sigma algebras, let's do the same thing again. So let's say a finitely additive measure mu on a Boolean algebra curly B is just a function that takes sets in the Boolean algebra. Goes to the extended positive reals, the reals of infinity Boolean, and then we just ask that the measure of the empty set is zero, and the measure of the union is the measure of the pieces, as long as the pieces are disjoint. Okay. So here's a question. That's the end of the definition. So I wrote this condition, which I said was only meant to hold if there were disjoint. So is it true that, in general, the measure of a union is the measure of one piece plus the measure of another piece minus the measure of the intersection? Let's have a vote. I'm sort of curious. I hope so. Who thinks this is true or hope so? You've got to put your hand up for yes or no. And who doesn't? Okay, we have a small minority of people who are right. Do you have a sense of what goes wrong or?
It's too good to be true.
It's too good to be true. Okay, then you've got to be more optimistic than that. It's true except for a minor technicality. Right, okay. The problem is we've got to be very, very careful thinking about measures and subtracting quantities because we could, for example, have what would be a good place where we don't want to. I guess the point is just that if E and F may be the same set and they both have infinite measure, all four quantities here will be infinity, and this gadget over here is not a gadget that has subtraction. whom we're only allowed to add in this set, because we don't have a handle of things. Okay, so it's not so bad. But what it does mean is that the very, very closely related thing that is true. just because why just because sorry. That doesn't make any sense. Oh sure, it does. Okay. So the point is that you can write this as you can write both sides as E minus F, F minus E, and then two copies. And get that. Okay? This is, well, you can see how it goes. Okay. So let's just have some easy consequences of being a finitely added measure. First of all, if you have an inclusion of sets in your Boolean algebra, that tells you that the measures are non-decreasing. Okay, just because you could write this as e plus some other bit. And then if you have a collection of disjoint sets, measure of the union. A finite collection of discrete sets. The measure of the union is the sum of the measures. It's just deducting on adding two things at once. And in general, non-discrete union. We just have that same expression over the inequality instead of the equality, which again you can prove by induction using that. Okay, so that's not too exciting. Then a measure, or a countably added measure if we want to distinguish it. A measure is a finitely added measure on a sigma algebra. Just satisfy the obvious condition that you've got. So E out is disjoint. There's counting many of them. And the measure. So then we could say the triple consisting of the underlying space, the sigma algebra, and the measure is a measure space. And you might say that just the pair X and a sigma algebra is a measurable space. Something that you might put a measure on but haven't quite yet. I probably won't use that terminology, but if you see it, that's what people mean. In some sense, measurable space is basically a synonym for sigma algebra.
With those axioms alone, would that not be enough to prove that holds true?
This? Yeah, no, this is not a consequence of, exercise. Just your favorite counterexample of all. Okay. Let's with some more facts. Standardized exercises. When the sets are disjoint, you have that. But in general, just an arbitrary union, the measure of the union is bounded by some of the measures of the individual sets. This one now is maybe does actually require slightly more thought than the corresponding statement we made for finite measures. Because the one for finite measures, we proved this just by induction on the number of things we were taking a unit of. You're not going to prove this one by induction. Okay. But two very important facts, hopefully, I think you've used before. We have some increasing union of sets that are all in the sigma algebra. Then the measure of that union so by what we observed before back over I think I've erased it there, just there the measures of these sets are increasing, and in fact the limit of those measures of the EIs. The point is that you get the measure there, and of course, since these are increasing, you can also write this as the of the measures of those sets. Here I'll write something that's incorrect, and you guys can see if you can see what's wrong. So I want to have a version of this where instead of having a tower of sets getting bigger and bigger and bigger, have a tunnel of sets getting smaller and smaller. I want to say the same thing, but the measure of the intersection, so as you go down here, is equal to the limit of the measures of the sets, which of course is the same as the infimum of the measures of the sets. Yeah, okay. So you need to, U of EI is eventually finite. Okay. As soon as one of them is finite, all of the subsequent ones will be finite too because of our inequality. So what goes wrong if it's not eventually finite?
You can like take like an infinite strip and R,
yep.
And around each point, say integers 1, 2, and 3, you can have like a box of, with 1 on n. So and then the measures will be 1 plus 1.
Yeah, I think we can do something easier than that. Well, maybe you were saying this, but if you just take the strip in R2 of height 1 over n,
yeah.
Go and get that. Okay. Each one of these sets individually just has infinite measure. Okay. So this limit or this infimum would be infinite. But the intersection here is just the real axis, which is maybe zero. So you do have to be very careful with that condition there. Infinities are annoying. Okay, so that's just the basic definitions of sigma algebras and equations. So I think now I want to start trying to explain a bit more of the detail of this connection between measure theory and integration theory in general. So I wrote up, I guess, two lectures ago, this statement of this theorem, saying that Radon measures and Radon integrals are the same thing. So let's get to work on this theorem again and trying to eventually prove it. So we need to have this notion of Radon measure. Apex is one of these locally compact clustered spaces we talked about, but I'm pretty happy if you think of metric space all throughout, and I don't promise, it's possible that at some point we'll just decide to switch to metric spaces to make our lives easier, but I'll try and keep going at this level of generality. So what is it? Before I say, let me define one of two things first. So say mu is a measure. So let's define a few adjectives. So we say mu is irregular. If the measure of any set is what you get by looking at the measures of compact sets inside, but you might hope that the measure that we give from the set is the same as the measure we get from looking at complex sets inside. That's the irregularity. And then we say mu is a radial measure. If it is irregular, measure of every compact set is fine. Okay. So the exercise to connect things back to what we've done before is the Lebesgue measure on our end is one of these measures. So let's think briefly about that. The second condition is easy, okay? If you've got some compact set in Rn, it's contained in some closed ball, and that ball has finite measures, and the compact set has finite measures. So that's easy. This one is maybe a bit less obvious. Did you guys talk about anything similar to this previously? Some yeses and some no's. I think that we're
sufficient to consider the case where A is
so it's sufficient. Okay.
Close. Yeah.
But I mean, so A here is just an arbitrary Borel set. Yeah.
Is every vegetable set like a measure or a set away from a closed set?
Yeah, absolutely.
Am I remembering that wrong?
How does that help us?
Not in compact most of the time. That's a little bit.
Oh, I see. Okay. So we can. So I guess the way we do it is.
Yeah. Okay.
So. Everyone will have dead pens. So how do you do this? So so if A is not bounded, we could just write A as a disjoint union of AJs, where AJ is the intersection of concentric shells of A, and we can see that A looks like that. These are all disjoint, and so the measure of A is certainly just the sum of the measures of the AJs. And does that actually help us? So if we knew this for each individual one, how would we then know that that was true for A itself? The problem is that that's not going to be a compact set.
But you can take K1, meaning K2, so on K1. And
the supremum doesn't. Great. Yeah. So then define, if you define LJ to be the union of some from I equals 1 up to J of some KIs with KI compact, and in AI with the measure of KI very close.
Epsilon divided by 2pi.
Yeah, very close to AJ, AI, minus a little bit, but a little bit that's summable. So then the point is that in the limit of the measures of these LJs, which are each compact, is at least the measure of A minus epsilon. Okay, so that's the argument that says that if you can prove this fact, if you can prove that a measure is irregular on all bounded sets, then you can prove that it's irregular on all sets A. And then Keeley's suggestion handles the case if A is bounded. So if A is bounded, C closed in A, so A take away C is measure 0, but then C is compact since it's bounded as well. Sorry, that was a bit of a mess. Any questions about either of the two halves there? Okay, so the point of this is to just explain that these radial measures are not unreasonable things to think about, because the only measure we know so far is a radial measure, and so we're going to try and study those. So maybe what I'll just do is quickly restate the theorem now that we've defined everything. I think we can now say what it is that we're aiming for. Let's grab this. Okay. So remember, have we said what it is? Yeah. So remember, we have radial integrals, and that's just positive linear functionals on you want to set up the correspondence between men on integrals and men on measures. Which were, well, just what we said. It's currently added irregular measures and compacts of finite measures. So, if we're going to set up some correspondence, we need to actually define what the maps forward and back are. And I think that so one way is actually pretty simple. If you at least. If you believe that given a measure we can take integrals of nice functions, it's pretty easy to do this. The positive linear functional we get from a measure is just integrating this function with respect to the measure. Technically, that's something we need to set up. We haven't actually set up integration theory for an abstract measure. But it's maybe a bit less obvious how we're going to go from here to here. Okay, so how do we produce a measure? So the idea is we'll just extend this linear functional to a much larger class of functions. Contain characteristic functions in sets A from any sets A, and then we'll just define we'll say the sigma algebra we get is the collection of all of those A's. The measure of one of those A's will, of course, just be the integral of the characteristic function of that set. So this integral symbol starts off as a linear functional here. We're going to make it into a linear functional from a much bigger set into the real numbers. And then we're going to extract some sigma algebra from that more widely defined linear functional, basically as the sets on which the integral is defined on the characteristic function. So we want to start doing this this extension. Now, going this direction is something that we might have avoided having to think about in a more conventional approach to abstract measure theory, where you just take these things as the things that really matter and then set up integration theory, which sort of is going that way. So you might feel like we're giving ourselves extra work going this way, but it turns out that the extra work we're about to do now was all stuff that was actually crammed into the section on the spectral theory later in the course, but not really explicit that it was doing this construction. And so we sort of have to do it anyway, and hopefully it's a little bit clearer. So let's try this. So let's define two new classes of functions. Oh, so here, maybe let's, for the rest of the next week or two, fix integral, a radon integral. Okay. So everything, these definitions I'm giving now are all with respect to some particular choice of. So define two new classes of functions. Same notation, CCX, but with a superscript M. And this will consist of all of the functions valued in the real numbers or possibly plus infinity, such that there exists a collection of compactly supported continuous functions which are increasing. Functions that have pointwise increasing limits, functions which are pointwise increasing limits of continuous compactly supported functions. So let's just have an example of something that's in here. This function, which is not continuous, is in this class, and the reason is just that you can take these continuous functions that are also zero out here, and then go up steeply and become approximately one, and then drop back down again. Okay? And if you imagine doing this in that little continuous plateau there is becoming, gets steeper and steeper walls sort of from the inside, you can see that it has these properties. This family of functions is increasing. An earlier one might have been that guy. Okay, so it's pointwise increasing. They're all continuous, they're all compactly supported, but this family of functions is pointwise converging to this discontinuous step function. But not this guy. Functions which were at this point here pointwise increasing to one, and they were all continuous, they couldn't also be at a point just immediately to the right, also pointwise increasing to zero. Okay? So, in fact, you can characterize this set. This is the set of lower semi-continuous functions. Which basically means they're almost continuous except you see this sort of behavior and never this one. So they're allowed to have discontinuities. Which is just saying that when you've got a discontinuity, the value at that discontinuity is is bounded above by the limits coming from either side, even if those limits are maybe I didn't think about that sentence very hard beforehand, so maybe let me not say too much more there. We'll come back to it if we need it. And then let's define a corresponding one, which is, because there's a lower m now, now it's allowed to have values including negative infinity. Maybe just as notation before I write this one, let's write here that the fn's converge upwards to f, to mean that, so this notation is the fn's are converging pointwise to f, and then, but it's pointwise in an increasing fashion. Okay? So here, the condition is very similar. We want some fn's which are continuous and compactly supported, but now we want them to decrease down to that. Okay? And then it's not so hard to see that these guys, well, this function here is in this set, even though it wasn't in that set, because you can have more bubble functions that surround this guy above. They converge pointwise down. Okay. So I have no idea what the time. seconds because the clock over there doesn't work.
How are we for time?
5:02. 5:02, so we should stop in just a moment. Let me... since we've got the tutorial coming up, let me write one more thing so we can stop in a slightly more sensible place. So you can then define two new integrals, one with an upper star that takes ccx upper m to r or possibly infinity, just by the upper integral of f is the supremum of the actual integrals of g. Where g is something we actually know how to integrate according to our original integral, and g is less than f, and similarly define the lower integral these guys by the corresponding formula with an infimum of the integrals and functions which are bigger than. I'm going to sort of abuse notation and now define another upper integral that just goes from arbitrary functions, from the reals to the reals. And now I was allowed to take values plus or minus infinity by the infimum of the upper integrals of g's now this is getting a bit nuts, so I'm going to have to draw a picture before that makes any sense, but let me just write out that definition. This upper integral was this one here, so this upper integral is the infimum of the supremum of the actual honest integrals of some h, where here h is in h is actually continuous and compactly supported, and h is less than g, and then I'm going to propose the supremum. And here g is just some choice of one of these guys at upper n, so g is bigger than n. Okay. That's a complete disaster until we draw a picture, and then it starts to become a bit clearer. And you'll start to see what our strategy is. I'm using that twice. It's a let's. Doesn't really matter. So this one is the one we defined here, and now we're defining an even sicker one. So what's the idea now? The idea is we've got some terrible function. I should make it look even more terrible. That we want to integrate. Okay, although we're wondering if we're allowed to integrate. Okay, so that's our f, which I failed to write here. So this upper integral is defined by the formula. Crazy upper integral of f is this infinity. Okay, so here's our f that we're wondering about integrating. And so what we're meant to do is consider g's that are bigger than it, which aren't quite continuous, but are in this fairly nice class of things that have a converging downward, converging upward sequence of continuous functions. So we might think about some G that's not so crazy, it's still got some discontinuities, okay? But they're not that sick. And so this here is our G in here. And finally, what we know is that if you've got a G in that class, then you can find continuous functions which are converging pointwise to it from below. It really doesn't work at all. But I need to have three colors. Okay, so we're thinking about, so this black line here is the H in that formula. Okay, so we're taking the supremums of integrals of these H's. As these H's come up from below to that blue line, and then once we finish doing that supremum, we take the infimum as this blue function squishes back down closer and lower to the red function. Okay. So similarly, we define this crazy version that's the lower one, that is a supremum over this lower integral of a g, of g in this other class of lower n's, which is less than an f. And so this integral is trying to do the same thing on the other side. It's saying, take some blue guy down here, in lower n, and then take some black guy that's continuous above that, and again, take the black ones down to the blue one, and after finishing that, try to take the blue ones up. And finally, define L1 to be just the set of all functions whose upper integral equals their lower integral. And we'll have to come back and actually study what this class of functions turns out to look like and behave like. But that's the idea there is we'll define these are just integrable functions. And the point will be that this class will certainly contain the original class CCX functions, they're certainly all in there. And if you just define integration of this guy by either using this guy or this guy, it doesn't matter, you get the same answer. And that's some extension of the linear function we started with that only knew how to integrate continuous functions to some gadget that knows how to integrate almost anything. Okay, we're going to have to come back and go through that again more slowly and explain how the two things work. Okay, so as usual on a Monday, let's pause for a few minutes, go get a drink, go to the toilet, do whatever you like. There's a new problem set 2 that we should have really talked about last week as well. I'm very happy to go through some of that and talk about it. Please also remember there's an assignment due in not too long. It's only 13 days away now. And I'm very happy to, no, 13, I can't, less than 13 days away. And I'm very happy to talk about that assignment to